What's up, guys? Welcome to Found Flicks. On this Ending Explained, we will be doing something a little bit different. Looking at a web series from the fine folks at Crypt TV. If you don't know Crypt TV, they're a channel that produces tons of original horror content, including awesome scary films and series. Make sure to subscribe to them if you haven't already. They've got new videos going up every Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday. Today we will be covering one of their shows, The Look-See, which is the de facto name of the creepy, stitched up, skin-flapped head, suit-wearing monster that is at the forefront of the series. And even though the entire 5-chapter season is about 16 minutes long, there is a staggering amount of clues and details crammed into its brief runtime that ties the chapters together and helps us understand the full story presented. So let's get cracking on The Look-See, explaining the story's many questions and easy-to-miss connections, as well as looking in-depth at the Look-See monster itself. Right off the bat, there are a bunch of little easily missable details in what is chronologically the first episode, The Mysterious Man. We open on a teenage boy who falls to the ground dead, learning that he is one of 13 children that were poisoned at what looks like their school's gym. At a vigil for the kids, we get our first momentary glimpse of troubled couple Ginny and Daniel, who we learn more about in later chapters. But based on the way he's glancing over at Marlene sitting nearby, makes it pretty clear what's going on. And from Ginny's body language, scooting away from Daniel, she seems aware of what's up between the two as well. From up above, another man, our mysterious man, watches over the proceedings, showing us by being here, he is somehow tied into the children's deaths in some capacity. On a photo board of the children, we focus on one picture in particular, the boy from the opening, seen with his mother. The shot then swoops to later with a police officer, and based on the picture is also the mother of the slain child, seen picking up the leftover numbers pertaining to each poisoned kid. And when she gets to number 4, she pauses, picking up the number, looking at it longingly. Presumably, this is the corresponding number for her son based on her reaction. And near it on the floor, she notices something. A crumpled up note which reads, "If you yourself will not release, it will come and take a piece." This ominous phrase is pretty much the fundamental backbone of the Look-See. The idea being that these people he targets have something they are holding on to in their lives, and this demon forces them to confront whatever that is. If they fail to do so, he will literally take a piece from them. As for the officer, she did lose her son and would be grieving. But it was like, what, 2 days ago? So I think that's a pretty fair grieving time considering. She quickly learns there is someone else in the school with her, the mysterious man, zipping around in the darkness behind her. After she sees him, she enters an attic to hide, inside seeing candles lit, along with a red fingerless glove, which belongs to the Look-See. And to me, this sure looks like some kind of ritualistic setup with the candles and stuff, along with the actual Look-See's glove, not an object tied to anyone else. I can't help but think that somebody actually summoned the Look-See here. Demons generally are attracted to violence and tragedy, and an event like the poisoning of 13 children certainly fits the bill. And this might be what brought it here in the first place. It then appears from the glove, looming over the officer. But before she gets attacked, the man appears, rescuing her. Obviously, the Look-See didn't appreciate that, lifting the man into the air, dragging him behind the curtain and slashing up his face, though not killing him. Since he still serves a purpose to the Look-See. The man is essentially working with or for it, and he is the one who writes the warnings to the monster's various victims. And these associates are previous victims that did survive its test, and were selected by the pocket watch scene here. In the next chapter, we see even after the school encounter, the man is still working with the Look-See, standing behind him while he scrawls his warning on the door of the bathroom stall. Frantically, Ginny, the same woman seen briefly at the vigil, runs into the bathroom, looking in fear towards the door. There could be any number of things that she's afraid of here, but I don't think it was the Look-See, since he was actually just in the bathroom. Maybe he just teleported, I don't know. Ginny locks herself in a stall, the same with the phrase seen just written, and it seems that at least the Look-See did somehow know where Ginny would run to. After reading the phrase and considering, she fiddles with her wedding ring on her finger. In Ginny's case, the thing she has to move on from or get rid of is the marriage with her cheating husband Daniel. Struggling to let go, she fondly remembers the moment that Daniel proposed to her, but realizes that's the past, and it's time, removing the ring and holding it over the toilet. Distracted by a loud bang from nearby, she looks down, seeing the Look-See's shoes, which I gotta say are looking mighty sharp. I appreciate a demon who strives to look his best. Looking over the side, nothing is there, but when turning, sees his shoes in front of the stall, and the Look-See peeks over the top, sending Ginny into a frenzy to flush the wedding ring, just out of reach. the Looksy pulling her towards it. She grabs the ring and appears to flush it, but it turns out not so much. Heaving, she looks behind her, noticing the Looksy's shoe again, and slowly turns up to him as he reaches out, attacking her. In the aftermath, we see Ginny's twisted body, still holding the ring in one hand, and as well, missing the other, the hand that would include her wedding finger. This part he's taken, symbolizing her inability to move on from her marriage. Though since Ginny at least attempted to move on, the Looksy didn't actually kill her, but it sure messed her up good. I mean, she's not gonna be dancing a jig anytime soon, that's for sure. But before we continue with her story, we move on to the mistress's mind, featuring the return of Marlene, the woman at the vigil Daniel was giving vibes to, beginning with her literally staring at a picture of Daniel and Ginny, and flips it over, finding a message from the Looksy waiting for her. Unabated by this, she tears up the photo, removing Ginny's half and replacing it in a way with herself in the reflection. I think for Marlene, the thing she has to let go of is her delusional idea that she can woo Daniel away from his wife, as the episode is called The Mistress's Mind. It's clear that Marlene is desiring to replace Ginny and be Daniel's wife instead. And indeed, it appears that she is preparing for a romantic rendezvous with Daniel right now, since when she hears a noise isn't frightened, calling out for Daniel in the empty house. Oh, except the Looksy is there, of course, since he's the one making the noises, appearing behind her when she checks the open front door. Though she doesn't see him, still thinking it's Daniel playing some kind of silly game of hide and seek or something. But when she makes it to the bedroom, realizes it's not Daniel, when the Looksy bears his claws over the door, then teleports to the ceiling behind her, sending Marlene to the bathroom to hide. Too bad the windows are sealed shut and there's no way out. So what to do? Hide in the bathtub. Great idea. He'll never look there. But things get quiet, and when she opens the curtain, the door is open, but there is no sign of the Looksy. Still terrified, Marlene begins to stand, the curtain then slamming closed and she screams. When the curtain is opened, Marlene has been decapitated, most likely her head being taken due to her trouble being related to her mistress's mind. And that is what she had to let go of, but failed when tearing up the picture. We then catch up with our mysterious man, standing on the edge of a building's roof, hearing the Looksy's pocket watch incessantly ticking. I'd wager the man has reached the limit of what he can take working for the Looksy and has figured out a way to make it end, falling off the side of the building, seeing the watch, which stops ticking, revealing the man dead on the pavement, face flattened, along with part of the top of his head missing. And with his death, the Looksy needs a new person to do its bidding, selecting Ginny, seen coming to in the bathroom, then waking up in a hospital bed, discovering what the Looksy has done to her. Here, the creature also appears to have the ability to bend reality, or indeed create its own dream reality, with Ginny waking up in a dream in bed, noticing the machines are off, and the clock on the wall has stopped moving. Looking around, she notices someone standing in the dark outside of the room. It's Daniel, who lingers for a little while before joining her sitting at the bed, Ginny staring at him in shock. Daniel's hand reaches towards her wearing the Looksy's glove and touches her leg. Then Daniel smiles, with his eyes completely missing. Since he was having an affair, this body part being taken could be defined as his wandering eye being the problem. Well, doesn't have that problem now. She pulls away from him, the Looksy on the other side of the bed waiting for her. He opens his fang-filled mouth, revealing a hand in his throat, holding the pocket watch, which it drops onto the bed in front of Ginny. She has been selected by the creature to be its next assistant, if she takes the watch. Instead, she grabs a fork, stabbing it into his chin, which does seem to harm it, backing away and writhing strangely. And when Ginny goes for a knife crawling after him, it seems he's actually trying to get away from her, backing away before falling down. Ginny aims to stab him in the head, but he is whisked away by an unseen force before getting hit. Now alone, she takes a seat on the bed, reluctantly grabbing the watch. And once it's in her hand, only now does she exit the Looksy's dream, with time resuming and the machines returning to life. Opening the eye-shaped watch's face, she again flashes back to Daniel proposing, then to later, the two solemnly sitting across from each other. This must be after she discovered his infidelity, but before the poisoning, as here she returns her wedding ring to him and Daniel walks away. It must be that after this, Ginny still struggled with moving on from their marriage, leading to the encounter with the Looksy in the bathroom. We also see the watches moving backwards in time, pertaining to how we can't let go of the past. A splatter of blood lands on her, followed by the fork. The Looksy has returned, and it's kind of comforting comforting to know that Looksie actually does bleed, so maybe it's possible to kill it, as said in the immortal words of Dutch and Predator. For now, we again leave Ginny, moving into our next chapter, The Father's Hug, first seeing a young girl, Camille, motionless in the water. Her unfortunate death is the big thing that her father, Jonathan, is struggling with. Today must be Camille's birthday, as he is seen dutifully preparing a cake, leaving out a slice for Camille across from him while he flips through an old photo book with pictures of her. Then in the pages, stumbling across a note from the Looksie, which disturbs Jonathan, as he seems well aware of what the note is referring to, dropping his cake on the floor. When he rises up, Camille is there in a red dress, the Looksie having taken her form. She then eerily floats backwards, Jonathan rushing towards her, but the door closes and she is gone. Searching the closet, he finds her red ribbon lying there, an obviously important memento tied to Camille, seen even wearing it when she drowned. Jonathan looks it over quizzically as the door behind him opens on its own. There is no one in the room, but the Looksie is right behind him in the closet, its head poking out until retreating into the shadows. He again peers out into the room before closing the door, the Looksie now on the other side as he closes it. Jonathan escapes to the kitchen, and upon seeing the things on the table, quickly does his best to get rid of the mementos. But the Looksie is on his tail, Jonathan deciding to instead hide under the table. The Looksie enters, shuffling by before hopping on top of the table, making Jonathan unable to know where he is, then looks down again, seeing Camille's ribbon now in front of him. But he appears broken down, frozen and unable to do anything, as the tablecloth lifts up and the Looksie joins him under the table, getting right up in his face. Well, looks like he didn't act quickly enough to let go of Camille's ribbon. Next, seeing the Looksie snatching the ribbon from his hands, revealing Jonathan with his head twisted around and both of his arms missing. Since its victim's death always tied to their issue, I would think his arms being taken symbolizes that he didn't properly show Camille that he loved her when she was alive, and the head twisted around being that perhaps he wasn't paying attention to her, and it was due to this that Camille drowned. No doubt his guilt over not only this, but not properly showing Camille that he loved her before her death would weigh heavily on Jonathan, and would be extremely difficult to let go of. But that's what the Looksie is all about. So, adios to your arms, buddy. In our final scene, Ginny sits at the same table she confronted Daniel at earlier, now in a wheelchair recovering after the hospital. She's seen scrawling the Looksie's verse on a piece of paper, then seeing the note is one of dozens she has written, spread out all over the table. As discussed earlier, Ginny is now the assistant or servant to the Looksie after the previous mysterious man's death, and she is the one that now alerts the victims to the Looksie before it arrives to confront them for what they can't let go of. That's the end of the story so far, but let's look more in depth at what we do know about the Looksie creature. While its origins are unknown, we do know fundamentally what it's about and its particular powers. Overall, we could consider it a demon in the traditional sense, and it most certainly is a supernatural entity, with the ability to teleport quickly and even take on the forms of deceased people such as Camille and Daniel. As for what brought it here in the first place, I still believe that it has to be connected to the poisoning of the 13 children. 13 is a spookily specific number associated with evil and bad luck, and I believe that it was the poisoning that brought him to the town, the event having such a significant amount of violence and pain that would be involved in a tragedy like that. The main drive of the Looksie is to almost test or judge people that have been burdened by something in their past that they are having trouble moving on from. The Looksie comes to help them out with this, first with its assistant planting its verse for them to find. Interestingly, the Looksie is somehow able to know where its victims will be beforehand and what actions they will take, such as the man knowing which stall Ginny would pick, or with Marlene and Jonathan, his assistant planting their respective pictures with the verse on them ahead of time. And hopefully the victims quickly get over whatever they're struggling with, because if not, the Looksie will take a significant body part for them that is symbolic of their situation, typically killing them as well. And even in Ginny's case, where she was definitely trying to let go, the Looksie still took her hand, though it did not kill her. Then there's its odd pocket watch, stowed away deep in its mouth, held by a hand within. It bears a cover in the shape of an eye, ironic considering the Looksie has none. The watch seems to be especially important to the monster, and is seen at least used in connection to selecting his assistants. If a victim does survive their encounter, he approaches them with the watch with the offer of working for him. We saw this explicitly with Ginny, but most likely this is the case for his previous assistant, the mysterious man. Overall, there is a lot to chew on in the first batch of episodes, but there are also many things left up to us to figure out on our own, and some questions that feel completely wide open. like who actually poisoned the kids. My best guess is that it was the mysterious man, and that he was the one that summoned the Looksee. Knowing how to draw it here via a ritual of 13 deaths, and wanted to act in his stead and help him in his tests. Though of course, him helping him out in the grisly murders eventually took their toll on the man enough to cause him to kill himself to make it end. Another big question, or something I feel hasn't been explored yet, is there's gotta be something else going on with Daniel, even though the Looksee shows him dead in the dream with no eyes. But we don't see this happen in real life. And it might just be me being a crazy person, but the fact that Daniel and the Looksee are played by the same actor seems interesting, and it makes me consider if somehow the two are connected in a way that has yet to be revealed. Did he summon the Looksee because of Jenny wanting to leave him, and he himself became the Looksee? Or did he maybe go crazy and was the one chasing Jenny into the bathroom? Or maybe he's just dead, and that's it. Who knows? But like I said, I think there is more to him than revealed so far. Perhaps in the next season, we will learn more about the story's bigger picture. And I'm excited to see things develop further when season 2 premieres sometime soon. Okay guys, that'll do it for my in-depth look at Crypt TV's The Looksee. Make sure to subscribe to Crypt TV so you don't miss out on any other quality horror content. What did you guys think of the show and its ending? Where do you think things will go next? Any lingering questions that I didn't cover? Leave your thoughts down in the comments below. Make sure to like, subscribe, and follow. Thanks for watching Found Flicks. See you next time.